a great pleasure to introduce our next speaker. Miki Agrawal is half Japanese, half Indian, affectionately known as half curry, half sushi, and grew up in Montreal until she was 18 years old. She graduated from Cornell University with a Bachelor of Science class of 2011. While here, the Cornell Daily Sun named her one of the top 30 most influential people at Cornell. Her entrepreneurial spirit kicked in at 25 years old, and she decided to start building the Slice concept. At 26, she opened Slice and is currently working on developing more Slice locations in New York City and in other cities, as well as building a frozen pizza line at Whole Foods stores nationwide. Her latest passion began in 2010, the Prance concept, a sustainable way for women around the world to live more comfortably without worry. So please join me in warmly welcoming Miki, who will be sharing with us a slice of her social entrepreneurship around the world. Thank you very much.
Hi. Who is a social entrepreneur? A social entrepreneur is somebody who makes a realization within a community and makes steps to actualize change. Let's go back to the mid-1800s. Florence Nightingale, she made a realization back in the mid-1800s that soldiers were dying because of unsanitary conditions, poor nutrition, and fatigue. There was no proper nursing practices. So without any knowledge of how to do this, she took the steps to open up her first nursing school in 1860. Without any background, any skill set, she made steps to actualize change. In the process, saved thousands of lives. Muhammad Yunus, 1976, I'm sure a lot of you know who he is. He made a $27 loan to 42 families in Bangladesh. With $27, he took 42 families out of extreme poverty. With this realization, he went on to start the Grameen Bank, a microfinancing bank to alleviate poverty and to help communities and organizations take themselves out of extreme poverty and start their own businesses. He had no idea what he had no idea to start a bank. He was a professor. He was an economist, but he took the steps to actualize change. Blake Mycoskie, in 2006, went to Argentina. While he was on his trip, he made a realization. He realized that kids weren't allowed to go to school because they weren't wearing shoes. These kids wanted to go to school so they could take themselves out of their situation, and yet they couldn't go to school because they didn't have shoes on. That was terribly unfair, right? So he took it upon himself, without any knowledge, any skill set, to start a shoe company called the TEDx, as I'm sure a lot of you know what it is. Again, he made that realization, without any background whatsoever, he made steps to actualize change. None of their stories are meant to be glamorous. My story is equally unglamorous. When I graduated from Cornell in 2001, I started off in investment banking working at Deutsche Bank. My first realization was that I was a terrible investment banker. Then I went on to play for the New York Magic, which is a WSA soccer women's team. And unfortunately tore my first ACL, right ACL, first season, and tore my left ACL second season. So that certainly was not my calling. So then I went back in the film business, and which I spent all my summers while I was at Cornell, working for the guys who produced Dumb and Dumber and King and dusted off my film resume and worked my way up from a production assistant to producing. So I made a realization that when I was 25, it was okay to try on many different hats. It was okay to not know exactly what my passion was. While I was at Cornell, while I was at in New York City all this time, New York City's a going out town. We all love to go out with our friends, right? New York City is a place where you don't stay in your apartment, it's your tiny little boxes, you don't cook in your home. You go out to eat. So I went out to eat every night with my friends, and every time I came home, my stomach hurt. I had tummy aches all the time. It was really frustrating. So I started doing research about food. What was I eating that was causing this? Why was I Why was I having these stomach pains, bloating, these issues? And I realized that I was lactose intolerant, and lactose intolerant to processed dairy, to dairy that was injected with hormones, that was fed antibiotics and pesticides. And upon doing more research, I found out that not only is there 1 billion people hungry in the world, there are 1 billion obese people in the world today. The processed food industry was getting more processed and producing food that wasn't technically food. So I started thinking about all of my favorite comfort foods. Pizza. Pizza. Who here loves pizza? Everybody loves pizza. It's our favorite pastime, it's our favorite memory, all of our childhood experiences and happy times stem from pizza, right? But pizza was one of those unhealthy indulgences that I couldn't eat anymore. The cheese was processed, the crust was bleached, all the sugar in the sauce, the toppings were processed. It was just something that I couldn't eat anymore. My body said no. And then I did some more research on pizza, and I said, wow, pizza's a $32 billion industry annually. It accounts for 10% of our food service sales. We, as Americans, eat 100 acres of pizza every day. Clearly, we love this food. And yet, nobody was making it better for you. As the food industry was starting to lean towards natural, organic, local, those words started to become more important as the obesity pandemic was increasing. We started to make that disconnect. Why was the pizza industry not responding to this vastly growing sector? Here's an opportunity. Here's an opportunity. Imagine a pizza that was made with whole wheat crust, that was supporting local farms, that was using organic ingredients, that had free-range toppings, that did not make your stomach hurt. So I went on to start Slice. In 2005, I opened my first restaurant on the Upper East Side without any background in food, any background in working in a restaurant at all, did not know how to chop an onion, didn't know anything. And brought in my smartest friends, put together the smartest group of people, and helped me build my concept. So in 2005, I opened my first restaurant. And what was really interesting about it was that pizza became a really interesting way to talk about food to kids. Kids understand it, they get it, and so as a result, we're able to open the dialogue about food. Where does your food come from? What are you eating? I bring a pie to the classroom and they say, I haven't eaten them at first, and they say, and I ask, what are you eating? And they say, I'm eating pizza. And I said, do you like it? Oh, it's delicious. Did you know that you're eating whole wheat crust? Ew. I'm like, no, you just said it's delicious. Oh, did you know that you're eating organic dairy? Ew, organic. No, you just said it's amazing. Like, so clearly, all of a sudden, they were like, oh, okay, this is good, this is cool. So it started this incredible conversation about food. Here's a Miki pizza named after me. It's whole wheat crust, basil pesto, it's a free-range crumble chicken sausage, fresh tomatoes, delicious. You guys should come try it sometime. So opened my first restaurant in 2005, opened my second restaurant in the West Village in 2009. We're opening another restaurant in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, coming up next, and then we're opening a Slice in Vegas, and hopefully in 2012. We're launching our first line of frozen pizza at Whole Foods. And we're writing a book called Give Pizza a Chance, which is about the history and evolution of Western civilization through the eyes of a pizza lover. So all this to say, again, all this started with one realization. The idea that there was this gaping white space between healthy comfort food. Food that was both delicious and good for you did not exist. Moving on to another project I'm working on. In 2010, last year, I went to the World Cup. Anyone go to the World Cup? Oh my God. What's up? Okay. So I'm a soccer player. I played here at Cornell. I played for the New York Magic. Obviously, it's one of my favorite sports. Never been to the World Cup. So I was excited to go to both Africa, both experience the World Cup, and to go on this adventure with my best friend, Michael. That's me at the U.S. Ghana game when we were robbed. Anybody watch that game? So while I was there, I made another realization. I realized that girls missed 25% of school and 25% of work because of their periods. They could not go to school, they stayed home 1 week a month because they had nothing to stop the flow. They were using sticks, leaves, dirty rags. A lot of girls were dying of infection. It was a taboo topic. No one was talking about it. So I did some more research about it. And I thought about maybe we send Tampax as something to send to them, or tampons, and talk to these companies. That's unsustainable, because these villages don't have garbage systems, they don't have plumbing, there's nobody coming to pick up trash. So it's just adding to trash. This is not a sustainable solution. So my best friend, my twin sister, who also went to Cornell, also played soccer here, and I, the three of us created a line of period underwear for women called Prance. And the concept is, for every pair we buy here, two pairs get donated to a woman in Africa, very much like Tom's. And the idea behind it is it's a leak-proof, stain-free product that when you wear, you can go to school, these girls can go back, 67 million girls can now go back to school and not worry about going to the blackboard and having an accident. So it solves a problem both here and there. Again, it all started with an idea and a realization that these girls were missing school. I had no idea how to do anything related to underwear, period, technology. We have a patented product now. You know, there's so much involved in making this happen. But it all started with that one realization, taking that first step. So all this to say is that social entrepreneurship starts with that one realization, that one light bulb, that one aha moment, right? When you think about Florence Nightingale, you all know, you've heard of her. Muhammad Yunus, Nobel Peace Prize. Blake Mycoskie, I'm sure some of you are wearing your shoes now. You know, my products you can hopefully see in the storefronts near you very soon. But it didn't just start, they didn't become big overnight. It started again at one realization, the first step. Can everyone stand up just for a quick second? Okay, I want you to look around. I want you guys to think about what's in your surroundings right now that sucks, that can be made better, that, you know, that's within your community, that you can do to take that first step. Think about where you are. You're at Cornell University, one of the best institutions in the country, in the world. You have the best professors. You have, you know, you have the Pillsbury Institute for Entrepreneurship. It's a place where amazing things happen. You know, rather than going to bars every night, you know, this is something that you can do to take that first step. You guys can actually, you know, if I could go back 10 years, I would love to take that first step and start building now while we have time, while our physiological needs are met. Maslow, we all took like 101, right? Where all of our Maslow's hierarchy needs are, we have roofs over our head, we close our backs, we have the table, we don't have to worry about that stuff. So the whole point is, let's take that first step together. I've done it, you can do it. That first step can be contacting a professor, that could be reading up about it, doing some research. It could be, you know, just having a lunch meeting, having a little, you know, group discussion with your friends, your brilliant peers who are here at this institution. So I urge you guys with me to take that first step and commit, and you too can be a social.